Welcome in to episode 7 of Covering the Bases. Daron Vaught here in the press box at Coleman Field at the USA Baseball National Training Complex. A beautiful day. No baseball being played at Coleman Field today, but nonetheless, it's good to be here, always. Our guest on Covering the Bases here in the 7th edition just finished up a stint as the Collegiate National Team manager and head coach for the summer for USA Baseball here. Fresh off of a trip to the College World Series. As a matter of fact, his 4th in 7 seasons. It's Louisville's Dan McDonnell. So let's get right to it. Colin, hit me with the open.
From high above Coleman Field at the USA Baseball National Training Complex in Cary, North Carolina, this is Covering the Bases with Daron Vaught.
All right, and now we welcome in the 2019 Collegiate National Team manager, Dan McDonnell of Louisville. Coach, good to see you. How are you?
I am doing great, man. This is I've only been here a few days, but I'm having the time of my life.
Well, it is somewhat familiar territory, right? You come in with the managerial position with this 2019 Collegiate National Team. You were an assistant, I believe, back in 2009. That was your first USA Baseball experience, and you guys got series wins in Guatemala as well as Canada. What did you take from that the first time around?
Well, you learned a lot, and I learned that Eric Campbell's probably the hardest working human being I've ever met. I mean, really, I had so much respect for just how hard he worked, and it was a reminder about, for me, because, you know, we're all head coaches on that staff, but, you know, at that point, you're an assistant, and no entitlement, no matter where you coach, and no matter where you play, we're all coming together, and we're putting the USA on our chest, so... we like to say it a lot, you know, no entitlement. You got to earn your stripes. You got to show up. You got to play hard every day. You got to come together as a team. And man, it really prepared me, hopefully, for this opportunity. I just learned a lot, especially going overseas to Japan. We finished the World Championships in Canada, which was really neat. And it's what I told the players this past week. It's a memorable experience is what it is.
Well, and speaking of which, you've got 4 of your own players along for this ride, which is really cool with Reed, Bobby, Michael, and Alex. What were your conversations prior to arriving here in Cary?
Honestly, I didn't want them to, you know, have any advantage or Reed, you know, was an early invite. But the other 3 guys, I think in the fall I had made the comment, everyone should have a passport. We take the team to the Dominican Republic every 4 years. So yeah, there's a good chance as a player. But they knew, myself being the manager this summer and them being talented young players. And so I'm sure I probably had several guys that had a passport. But I just, you know, I wanted them to go out this spring and earn it. And so Reed, you know, was an early invite. But the last 3, Bobby, Kieran and Alex, but no, you know, it was just, you know, they finished strong. They had a great year. We looked at the roster and we thought, yeah, you know, as the committee all did, we thought these guys could help us. So I've tried not to meet with them separately. I want them to have the same experience that everybody else has, and I don't want them to have an advantage because I'm the manager, but I don't, you know, want them to either feel like they should be like just the other players, a little bit nervous. And they got to win a job. They know that. And but it is special for me knowing you got kids from your program, your system that you trust and you know are going to be able to help us if they're able to make it.
Part of that, too, I imagine why you didn't have specific conversations about this is that up until very recently, you guys were in Omaha trying to get a national championship. So I'm sure that played a part in it. That was your 4th trip with Louisville to the College World Series. And you guys have been, you were there as a player as well, as you played at the Citadel. What's that like? Because if we have a lot of people in our listening base who are huge baseball fans at every level, and maybe they haven't been to Omaha to the College World Series. It's obviously a different perspective if you're coaching there. But what can you say, generally speaking, about Omaha and the festivities around the College World Series?
Fortunately for me, I had to see it from two different sides. I went as a player in 1990 at the Citadel. And that was very much like a Hoosiers moment, you know, when there's the like little small school beats Miami in that regional twice, the Atlantic regional down there, and you're dogpiling and you're going crazy. And, you know, we just wanted to win the Southern Conference that year. We wanted to dethrone Western Carolina, who had won it the previous 5 years. And we just really wanted to win the Southern Conference. And when you get into the NCAAs, you're like, okay, we get to keep playing. And as I've learned, sometimes that's scary. When teams are in the NCAAs just happy to be playing, there's a freedom to that. But, you know, as a player, you're in your little bubble. It's all about yourself. And when I went as a coach in 07, so we've actually been five times at the University of Louisville. 07, I got to see a different perspective. And as a coach, you got to see the parents and the family members, and even for me, friends and alumni and all these people. And it really opened my eyes. I mean, Omaha is way more than just the eight teams that go there. What makes it is the people. And I've always expressed that to our players, and I've learned how to maybe help us play a little better in the super regionals, because it's so hard to get to Omaha. And the Super Regionals is such a bear of a weekend that I just try to keep reminding my kids, man, enjoy this. This is the most exciting weekend in baseball. Obviously, Omaha is special, but if you make it bigger than it is, then the baseball becomes even harder. So we went in 7, then took us a while. We got back in 13, 14, 17, and then 19. So it's been a lot of fun. And yes, that's part of the reason I did not talk about USA Baseball, because those kids were trying to win a national championship. But as soon as we were eliminated, I called that night after midnight, Bobby Miller to my room, sat down, Alex Benelis to my room, sat down, and I didn't even tell Kieran until the next morning just because of the hour and knowing they got to prepare. Like in less than 72 hours, they're going to be coming down to Cary and trying to make this team.
So you have players on this team this summer, and by the time people hear this, the tour will actually have been played out. So you guys have the Cuba series here in the States. You're going to Taiwan, going to Japan. You have guys from several different college baseball teams on this roster. It had to be a pretty special being the manager of the team and getting the assignment to tell those guys, hey, you're going to be able to represent the United States. How did they react, each individually?
It was one of the most enjoyable springs I ever had. I mean, I follow college baseball, but I'm not on social media. I'm not on Twitter. I'm the last one to really know when things happen, just because I want to live in my little bubble, and I just want my focus to be on my players, my program, my family.
Sure.
Obviously, I need to know what else is going on out there, but I let my assistants fill me in on that. But this year, knowing that you were the manager, you had to be in tune to what was going on. So I watched more games. I looked up more scores. I mean, you know, I used to just look up scores of my friends coaching in the business. And now I'm sitting there at night or early in the morning, and I'm, you know, I know who the watch lists are, and I'm just flipping through box scores, and I'm seeing how they're doing, and I'm talking to scouts, and I'm talking. So I really enjoyed it, just kind of seeing what else was going on in the country. And then we specifically, when we put the staff together, we got a great staff, but I knew we were going to be dominant in the East Coast. I knew we were going to have ACC and SEC connections. I asked Eric Campbell, I know there's great coaches in the West Coast, but the ones that I know, I've already done it, so I don't think they'll do it again, but can you give me some names? And so we started recruiting coaches out there, and we were so fired up to get a Greg Moore from the West Coast. And so I really think when you look at our roster, I didn't want it to be dominant one part of the country or the other. I think we got a nice mix. We got Texas kids. We got Arizona kids, California kids. Obviously, we got those through the SEC and the ACC. We got a Northeast guy from Boston College. So, I mean, it's just I'm excited because it's fun following these kids. And as I told them in the first meeting, whether you're here for 6 days through the trials or for a month, it's going to be a memorable experience.
Well spread out on the roster. I do agree with you there. When you got the call yourself to be the manager this time around, the head coach of the USA Collegiate National Team, what was that like for you? Because you had experienced it before, but this is a little bit different.
I've had a few of those phone calls in my life. I got a phone call from the Citadel. Dan, you're going to go into the Citadel Athletic Hall of Fame. And, you know, you're driving and you almost just want to pull over and you're just so appreciative. It was similar to that. When you get that phone call, again, especially for me, I spent 12 years at a military school. So for 12 straight years, 4 years I wore the uniform, run by military. And then 8 more years I coached there. So for 12 years from the age of 18 to 30, I was on a military campus. And so for me, I got so much respect and pride for this program. When I got the phone call, again, I thought back to the Citadel. I wouldn't be in this position if it weren't for those years there and the honor that I had. And I was just very humble and appreciative about it. But the competitive juices immediately kicked in, and that's where I started game planning out coaching staff, roster. I'm a big highlight video guy. I'm a big motivational guy. Books and who's going to speak to the team and what videos are we going to show. And I love it. I love that challenge of trying to motivate kids to come together and play for one cause.
I want to go back to your comments about sort of you changing your way, the way you consumed college baseball this season. Did that involve a method serve you any better as a head coach, do you feel? Is it something that you're going to maybe start to take bits and pieces of in years going forward?
I think, you know, now because of all the synergy and all the video capabilities out there, even in scouting reports, you know, there's so much video and I could just click on. So when anytime we brought a name up on our list, I could just click on the school and the name and I could watch him pitch or watch his at-bats. And so, yeah, I think you always learn. I know in coaching, I've learned an awful lot from players. So, you know, when I coached in 09 and Christian Colon, Yasmani Grandal, Colton Wong, Garrett Cole, Sonny Gray, Trevor Bauer, you know, Chad Bettis, like, you know, these names are so recognizable today. Drew Pomerantz, that I remember how much I learned that summer from them. So I think we're always learning, and I learned a lot just from watching kids play and watching pitchers pitch and just being with these guys in a short period. I've learned a lot.
And then you made reference to, obviously, your time at the Citadel. We talked about it earlier. You played in the College World Series in 1990. You've both played and coached when it was at the old Rosenblatt Stadium. Now at TD Ameritrade Park, you've seen both. Do you have a preference? Is the Rosenblatt Field, does nostalgia take over to give it the edge?
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to not. You love TD Ameritrade, and just the, there was a couple times this last year when you look around and the crowds are just, it's out of control when you're playing in those night games and a weekend afternoon or a night game during the week. And it is just, it's crazy how many people there are. But always great memories of Rosenblatt, you know, having played there and then our first trip there. It's just different. Our first trip at Louisville, we played 3 games there. We hit 8 home runs in those 3 games. You know, then I've also played in the TD Ameritrade where I think 2 or 3 were hit in the entire series. We're hitting more. Now we're hitting more. I think they hit 14 or 16 or whatever this year. But it definitely plays big. The wind blows in. I think you do have to have a team suited for that field if you're going to win it or increase your chances of winning it, because you just can't, you know, the old gorilla ball or 3-run homer. It's just hard to do that out there. So it just reminds me every time we go out there, you got to be athletic in the outfield. You got to have some team speed. And then again, good hitters are good hitters. They're going to hit anywhere. So I hopefully I learn every time we go out there.
Does coaching at TD Ameritrade, do you change your mindset or anything strategically based on that trend, the less home runs?
Well, I knew there was a couple of games there we were probably going to have to try to hit and run or bunt or just steal, you know, because just we you know, jumped on a couple of balls and they didn't go out and the wind's blowing in. And you're like, if those two guys can't hit a home run, then I probably don't have a guy that can hit one today. So you better, you know, what's our job as coaches? Put our players in a position to succeed. So you better start doing things to try to help them succeed. And it helped us in the Auburn game. And it gave us a chance to even win the Vanderbilt game when we double stole second and third and throw into the outfield. We scored a run. Then we got a hit. So we had the lead after the seventh inning there. But it was because of just thinking we're not going to hit a three-run homer. So you better try to push the envelope.
All right, let's pause for a second. More from Collegiate National Team manager Dan McDonnell shortly. I want to tell you about the new Fresh Hook 5950 and 950 caps that you can get over at usabaseballshop.com. It comes in navy, red, or white, features a raised, embroidered USA Baseball star logo on the front, and the stitched New Era flag at the wearer's left side, and an embroidered American flag on the rear. 100% polyester, maybe the cleanest design of any cap you'll find at usabaseballshop.com. I'll redirect us to what is literally in front of us. And as we're recording this, the tarp is out on Coleman Field. You guys are planning to play another red versus blue game here this evening. And our 10U Futures Tournament is happening on the premises as well. The players were supposed to sign autographs for them. So, again, appreciative of you for the time. With this team, you talked about getting the call, talked about your guys that you were able to tell that they had made this team. Have you ever been to Taiwan or Japan personally?
In 09, that staff, we went to Japan. I remember it like it was yesterday. Was very new. You know, just there were so many things about that experience that Eric Campbell knew. You know, one, if I'll be flattered and honored if I could manage the team in any summer, I would say yes if you ask. But if it were to work out where the series is in Japan, I just feel like that could suit me best because, you know, I was on a staff where we had a chance to win the series and we were up 2-1 and we lost game 4, didn't play well, and we took that to heart and we came out in game 5 and we were playing great and we took a lead in the 9th and we couldn't close it out. And we lost in the 11th on an error in the infield. And I won't even say the guy's name because I don't want it to act like he was the reason because he was a superstar. I mean, he was just an unbelievable player. But, you know, we lost in the 11th inning. And I remember watching that player, you know, bawling his eyes out and crying in the dugout. And I just remember the feeling I had. I thought, man, this is awesome. It's July. I got kids crying, like yeah. College kids. Just how thankful I was. I mean, I was not happy that we lost.
Sure, you're heartbroken for the kid.
But just thinking, man, this is nothing against summer camps and recruiting, but man, this is awesome. I'm wearing USA across my chest, and I got passionate kids who are putting on the line, and we saw those kids come together, and they bonded. Lifelong friends, and we went to Canada and won the world championship. So I just felt like, you know, I want to avenge that loss. And so I've been real challenged to prepare the coaches, prepare the players. We met in November and December as a coaching staff, and I had them come to Louisville for a weekend. We had mapped out a day. We had a PowerPoint. We had videos. We talked about the history of what it's like and the challenge of going to Japan. And I just really wanted these coaches to be fired up and just challenge them about what we have to do to win over there. And so I love the Gold Standard book by Mike Krzyzewski, and I bought all the coaches a book and I gave them one. I said, guys, I've read this a handful of times. I got sticky tabs all throughout it, man. If you read this book, it'll give you a good insight as to what it is to, you know, coach a USA team And so even in our first team meeting, I had a PowerPoint and I showed a couple videos and I put the book cover on the screen and I talked about Coach K. And, you know, I laugh because these players, they know Coach K as, well, that's the guy who coached Zion. You know, they don't. So, but I don't know if they really understand his involvement with USA basketball.
Of course.
And appreciate that. So I wanted to give them a little history of the book and what he's done with USA basketball. And then I read from the introduction and I talked about there's three things he talked about in building the team: time, goals, and competition. And I wanted to get that across to these 34 kids in this meeting room, that time, we only got 6 days, so we're challenged there. Goals, we talked about our goals. We play three series: Cuba, Taiwan, and Japan. And I talked about the history of not having won that series since 1974. And so we talk a lot about 1974. So I wanted to get some goals and then competition. That's why you're here. This is what the Blue-Red series is. Let's run out there and compete. And so I just, for me as a coach, just the challenge of pulling coaches and players together, again, to do something remarkable, I think is just a great opportunity.
So you mentioned Coach K. Have you ever had the chance to talk to him about coaching or meet him?
Well, I haven't, but that's one of the treats that we get to do. Our entire USA Baseball national team program, we're going over to meet with him, and he's going to share his thoughts and I'm sure have a great message. And as soon as I got the call, I just remember thinking, all right, what's the schedule look like? How many days do we have? Who are we putting in front of these guys? Because we only got 6 days. So we got to, and so we penciled down some names, and Ray Tanner, and he had some great runs with USA Baseball, and Rick Jones. Rick Jones was the manager in 09 when I did it. And so he might shed a tear when he talks about that Japan series. I know, I mean, it still bothers him today. He'll start to turn red when I say it to him. Yeah, that's just how competitive he is. But, and then I thought, you know, Coach K, I had already read his book. Man, he's right there in Durham. If we could get him, get our players in front of him, ooh, what an opportunity it would be. So we started working on this, you know, way back. And fortunately, he's in town and he's willing and eager to do it. So, man, that's going to be a real treat with this team.
How cool. I'm going to have to check back in and hear how that was.
Oh, I'm just
sure.
Hoping that, you know, we're going to have some foul shooting contests and just to get on the floor. That's what I'm a hooper, so I love to obviously we can't mess around, let these guys play, but any competition, I love competition, so maybe he'll let us shoot around a little bit.
Yeah, no, it's a bucket list thing, right?
That's
take at least one shot on the floor at Cameron Indoor Stadium. You mentioned Japan. I am fascinated by their culture as a country. They love their baseball. They respect the game in ways that I don't think you see anywhere else in the country. They've come here for this series in years past, and I've had the privilege to call those games and kind of see it up close. What were your impressions when you went to Japan back in 09?
I loved it. I loved, you know, I only saw certain parts of it, so it's hard for me to act like I know everything. But just what I saw a hardworking country. I saw a fast-paced country. I saw a polite country. You know, I just thought, man, these people move fast where they're trying to get to, but yet they're courteous. They're nice. You know, I come from New York. we move fast too, but we're not as friendly.
Not as nice, right?
You know, there's a little more edge in New York City. So I just remember thinking, man, these people hustle. They work hard. They're polite. It's clean. You know, the place, it was just clean. They love fish, white rice, and fruit. You know, and I just, I mean, it was just such a neat experience. But let's not paint them out to be that nice, because, well, between the lines, they compete. I mean, they take so much pride and they compete. And so that's ultimately what I respected most, was when the umpire says play ball, it's on, because they prepare, they practice very hard. And so when they get a chance to play it, they're very competitive.
Coach, I want to bring up one of your former players, and before we started even recording, I mentioned him, because our initial plan for this episode of the podcast was to have both you and Brendan McKay on for an interview. Brendan has been spending some time with the AAA Durham Bulls, so he's local. We figured, hey, well, let's just sit down with him while he's here. Well, it didn't take him long. He's gotten the call to make his major league debut tomorrow, as a matter of fact, for the Tampa Bay Rays. I mean, this guy, it was only 2 years ago. He won the Golden Spikes Award. What can you tell us about Brendan McKay and what explains this very, very fast trajectory?
We were blessed to coach him. He showed up on our campus as a freshman our first year in the ACC. And you couldn't ask for, you know, we were going from the Big East, then the AAC, and we were going into the ACC. And so, all right, we're going. Here we go. This is a great baseball conference. And little did we know, we were getting, you know, arguably the best college baseball player ever in three straight years. He's the only player to ever win three-time John Olerud Award. No one's ever won it more than once. He won it three times as the best two-way player in college baseball. And then his junior year, he won seven national players of the year, all seven. Just amazing. And what I loved about him was he had no entitlement. There was no arrogance about him. He never made it about himself. You can't have that much success if you're not a team guy. And no one was ever jealous of him. He never rubbed anyone wrong. He was just a team guy. And I'll never forget, in his junior year, they were doing an interview with him, as he did so many that year. And he hit four home runs in a game, and he was on a tear. And you know, at this point, late in the season, looks like we're going to win the ACC and be a national seed and all this great stuff. And they asked Brendan, could you tell us the highlight of this season? And he said, he paused, and then he said, oh, I think it's the bus ride to and from Georgia Tech. And the reporter's looking at him like, maybe he didn't understand the question I asked. And it was kind of silent. And then Brendan said, man, we had so much fun on the bus, and we just played games, and I just love being with my teammates. And that really, like we say, we learn a lot from these kids. I learned a lot about Brendan, you know, and it reminded me that the great ones are great for way more reasons than how hard they throw the ball or how far they hit it. This guy was a great team player. And we challenge our players all the time to do two things: be professional and be a great teammate. And Brendan McKay was the epitome of that. Now we can obviously, man, let's talk about the skill set. I mean, left-handed pitcher, you know, he started off 90 and then it became low 90s and then it got to mid 90s. He always had that big breaking ball. I mean, that big curve ball. And as lefties started to handle his fastball, you know, as he got a little older, he developed the cutter and just put together three unbelievable years on the mound. He was our four-hole hitter from, you know, early in his freshman season. He ended up playing great defensive first base, and we won a lot of games in his 3 years in Louisville.
So you've had players that you've coached collegiately that have been big leaguers. You've done that with pitchers and hitters alike. I actually got to know Adam Engel a little bit the summer he played in the Coastal Plain League. I was broadcasting in that league. What's that been? Seven or eight summers ago. But with that in mind, with Brendan, he's a two-way guy, as you mentioned, arguably the best two-way guy ever in the college ranks, and he's trying to do it as a big leaguer. We've seen it sort of sprout around Major League Baseball. What do you think the role of a two-way player is in today's MLB?
I think it's obviously being accepted by professional baseball. It starts with them. They have to accept it, and that's what you see with Ohtani and now McKay, and then there's others, and I think it wouldn't shock me if they come up with a hybrid player or a rule for being a two-way guy, maybe add a player on the roster or something to that effect.
Yeah.
Where we need to do something because there's these unique players that can do both. So maybe we need to add a spot or something of that nature. And I think you're going to see more and more two-way players as we're seeing. But it's amazing to me. I just remember going into his senior year thinking, it sounds like he's a first rounder on the mound, sounds like he's a first rounder as a hitter. This is unheard of. Like, so how do you not take this guy, you know, early in those top five picks? Because you're getting like two first rounders,
sure,
with one pick. So,
and they might both work out.
That's right. And even, but even if one didn't work out,
it's still a pick well spent.
That's right. You still think it's going to work out in the other one. And I just wanted him to go to an organization and a team that would really value his skill set. And I think the Rays have done an unbelievable job, because they probably could have brought him up even sooner, I think, as a pitcher. And I think Eric Campbell will tell you, you could have taken him from that USA uniform and dropped him in a big league stadium right then, and he was ready to pitch. And not that he wasn't ready to hit, but we all know it takes hitters a little bit of time in the minors. And I'm so impressed with how the Rays didn't rush him, even though it took him, you know, only 2 years, but they let him pitch at every level, and they kept the pitch count down. They let him hit at every level. And so now they feel like, as we know what he did in Durham, they feel like they have a guy who's big league ready as both.
Yeah,
as a hitter and a pitcher.
And that's a tough progression, because you talk about a guy like that essentially being two draft picks. One of those skills could develop way faster than the other. For the way that they did it, it seems like each skill kind of grew with his assignment as he got further and further up the ladder. So, no, I've been impressed with it as well, no doubt about it. When you found out, you said you're probably the last to find out things. Did your coaching staff have to inform you that he had been called up, or did you find that somewhere?
No, it just shows you I am definitely the last one to find out, because I actually got a text from his agent last night. But the problem is, our first night here, we were up to about 2:30 in the morning, just after the first
so
experience.
So you were about 24 hours behind.
Yeah, and so I fell asleep early, and I get up early. And I saw the text, and right away I'm in like recruiting mode. And so I fire off a text to my player development guy and our coaches staff, and should have known, you know, I get a text back, you know, 30 minutes later, because I probably fired it off about 6 a.m. We know, coach, it was tweeted last night. And, you know, I'm like, oh gosh, that's sometimes the negatives of not being on Twitter. I fired off a text to McKay. He shot back to me, and there's a lot of happy people now. One of our coaches is actually flying to Texas to be at the opening. It's
cool.
It's important for us. We can't make every Will Smith got called up this year.
Yeah.
It was in the middle of our season, so you can't. But when Josh Rogers got called up in the fall, you know, our pitching coach went. Now our pitching coach and hitting coach are both recruiting, so our other coach is gonna go and see him play. So yeah, we're gonna try to be there to celebrate with him.
Sharing only as much as you want. It's his personal, obviously. Can you tell us anything about the message you sent Brendan when you found out?
It's always congratulations. I'm super happy for you. You know, for me, it's always a balance of just be happy and congratulate him. But because I'm a coach and I was his coach, it's like I always want to coach him. So I got to be careful sometimes, you know, but I did want to throw in one little shout about, you know, go dominate those dudes, you know, like I had to send something like, you know, like that from a coach, like don't just be happy to be there. But like I said, I got to be careful, because, you know, it is a celebration, but you know, the game is the game. And when they get between the lines, you got to perform. So, and I think, you know, I think he appreciated that. And when he heard I was with USA Baseball, he fired off some cool text messages, because he got to experience this twice and just loved it.
Coach, I've got a couple, maybe a little more off the board questions for you. I'm based here in the Triangle of North Carolina, so I do play-by-play for a lot of ACC games, and get every now and then the chance to catch you guys when you're on the road at UNC and at NC State, that sort of thing. Do you have a favorite road environment in the ACC?
I don't know about favorite. You know, Florida State is beyond difficult to play there, just with the quality of their players, that ballpark, their fan base just has a lot of history.
It's got a sort of an SEC feel to it, right?
Yeah, I think you said it right, and we don't like to admit that as ACC coaches.
No, I get it.
But it's just. I mean, it is fair. But NC State and North Carolina, you know, the Duke series this year was at the Durham Bulls Park, so that's a neat place to play. I have a lot of fun playing there, and of course, you know, Wake Forest has had some really good teams over the years. So I so much love the ACC, and I just think back to my first conference call, and on the phone, you know, at the time is Jim Morris and Mike Martin and Jack Leggett and Mike Fox and Elliot Avan. You're going through, and Danny Hall, and you're just sitting there and you're going through all the names, and it was kind of one of those first, like, oh man, like, you know, like I'm a cocky, confident person.
It had to be at least a little bit overwhelming.
No, like I said, it was, and I hope I'm not arrogant, but I'm so competitive, and I believe we could beat the Yankees, like that type of toughness. But I just remember sitting there in my office, and all these guys are, you know, the names are being called out, and the roll calls there, and I'm like, wow, like we better get it going, because I mean these names I have known for a long time, And if I know your name for a long time, that means you've done it for a long time. That's just not easy. And that means you've done it at a high level. So I got off the conference call, and I remember I called all the coaches in my office, and I shared that with them. Like, I know we work hard, and we've been great to this point, but we got to do more. We got to be better. And I always think back to that. I think it's why we did so well in those first few years, because we just had so much respect. Like, we were just afraid to just take a deep breath and act like we had arrived. I mean, we showed up every day, and we were on our P's and Q's, and we go 25-5 and break the record for ACC wins in the history of that league. And I just remember thinking, how did you do it? Well, we did it because our kids were, there was probably some fear in there. And so we just didn't have any letdowns. Like, we showed up every day ready to play. And that's probably the biggest challenge we all have as college coaches. They're college kids, and you play 56 games, and it's real easy, you know, for them to not show up at a high level day in and day out.
Because you mentioned Florida State and you mentioned him specifically, Mike Martin just retired, 40 years, made the NCAA tournament every single year, and then a bit of a miracle run to Omaha this year with what maybe of the many, many College World Series teams he had, maybe the least talented or the least expected to be there. What kind of relationship have you had with him, and what mark do you think he's left on the ACC?
Yeah, nothing against Paul Maneri, because I know him well, but, you know, selfishly and being an ACC guy, knowing it was Mike Martin's last year, you know, like probably most of the country, you know, we were rooting for him. And I just remember, and I've talked a lot about him in the last spring, and even through Omaha as they were asking. I just remember, I probably remember most walking towards home plate after every game. And if they got the best of us, which they did often, he always had something comforting to say. And as a coach, when you lose, it just, you got to walk out the dugout and be classy and shake the other guy, congratulate the other guy, and always try to be, I hate to say, a great loser. Not that I like losing, but when I lose, man, you got to shake the other coach's hand and respect that they won, and they deserve it, so congratulate them. And I just remember his response was always so respectful, so warm, so genuine. He just made you feel a little better, you know, and it's just hard when you lose. And on the flip side, when you got the best of him, he made you feel better, because he'd always come up with a really good phrase, and you took us to the shed, and man, you know, he'd have some country saying.
Yeah, some southern North Carolina colloquialism.
And so it was one of my favorite hands to shake. The 5 years I got to compete against him, because, and what I've said a lot about him is, I think as coaches, we'll remember his kindness. Now, I didn't know him when he was 25 or 30, and I'm sure when we're younger, we're different. And I got to know him, you know, the latter part of his career, and I think we're all just going to remember how well he treated people. And you can't coach for that long without being successful. And not to act like those wins aren't important, but I think we're going to remember the personality and the kindness as much as anything.
That's fantastic. Coach, one last thing for you, and I made a note of it. I told you I do some ACC Network extra games here in the area. And on the day of the Kentucky Derby, I happened to have Louisville softball at NC State softball. And their coaches were telling me about, I had asked, they had a lot of fans in attendance that were wearing their derby hats, but they were red and black derby hats. And I mean, I'm telling you guys brought a crowd that day, and it was this celebration away from home. And it got me thinking, man, when I get Coach McDonnell sat down, I have to ask him about coaching a spring sport at Louisville. So it obviously you have some overlap with the Kentucky Derby, and that is a very, very culture-centric thing in Louisville. What kind of bleed over is there? What's that like to experience that and just be around it in the days before, on, and after Derby Day?
I think we all know when you coach in the ACC, you're going to have some carryover with basketball. So it's February, and you can't take it personal. You know,
it just happens.
That's right. It's crunch time, and that February, March, you don't want to compete with basketball. And we're okay with that. Like I said, I think we respect it so much. But once basketball ends, then baseball becomes front and center throughout the league, and we are until the Derby. And so, again, we have to take a back seat. And I just learned that. Like, don't try to fight the Derby. And we're not there anyway, so we're out of town. But I think it is really cool. And for people that don't know, if you're at our baseball stadium, you could hit a driver, and you got a chance to hit it into Churchill Downs. And if you go up on our concourse, then obviously you see the steeples and you're that close. So I think what our players appreciate as they get older is that first Saturday in May when, you know, 150,000 people, you know, are coming to the Derby, that, you know, their baseball stadium is right across the street. And so they ship us out of town and we have to watch it from a hotel, you know, room. But my wife gets to go every year and take, you know, another family member or girlfriend or some female who wants to experience it. But it's not just a day. It's not just a race. It's a way of life. And it starts the week before. All the talk shows are at the track on the backside early in the morning. They start at 7 a.m. It's like high school kids will go to the track before they go to school. People will go to the track before they go to work. And it's just, it is, I've learned to embrace it, enjoy it, get into it. And then as we've learned, the street fills up. And so, you know, Friday is the Oaks. Thursday is called Thurby, you know, the Thursday Derby. And it just gets busier and busier each year. But I got one cool story. One year we were in the Big East and they goofed on the schedule. And I have to admit it, because we looked at the schedule and we saw that we were playing home on the Kentucky Derby. We probably should have said something, but we didn't. We kept our mouth shut. And our admissions, I mean, our athletics were in football at the time and all this and stuff. So I don't think they realized it till like the middle of basketball season, and they panicked. And I hate to admit it, but we played dumb. Like, really? We're home that weekend? No way.
And, well, part of you had to at least wonder, be like, man, that'd be kind of cool, right? Well, I wonder what it would be like.
Maybe that's hectic, thinking, but I just thought it was, you know, maybe it's a gift from God saying, hey, Dan, I'm going to let you go to the Derby one time. So Rutgers had to stay about an hour and a half away. They had to get escorted in, police escort. Every day, for some reason, I thought 150,000 people across the street, we'll open our gates. It's free admission. I got to fill this place up, right? Wrong. It was crickets. There was no one. No one. Their mindset was going to the Derby. Fortunately, we won the game against Rutgers. We ran up to our office. I put my suit on. We ran over to the Derby. I got to see one Kentucky Derby.
Because I was going to ask, knowing that they usually schedule you guys on the road, I thought it's a shame if one of the head coaches at Louisville has never been to the Kentucky Derby. So that actually makes me happy. I'm glad you got that one.
That's right. You check it off your bucket list, and now it's like spring training. You hope you never get to go because that means you got a job. You know, if I start going to spring training or the Kentucky Derby, then that means I'm not coaching anymore. And at least right now, I don't think that's a good thing.
Well, Coach, we're at about an hour. I don't want to take up any more of your time, but man, it's been fun. I appreciate you stopping in the press box here at Coleman Field. I mean, hopefully this rain lets up and we get to play a little baseball here soon, but thanks again.
This is the perfect time, I mean, for a rain delay, and I'm honored. And I could sit up here for 3 hours and talk about USA baseball and my experience. And as much fun as I had coaching in 09 and I'll have coaching this summer, I get just as much joy when one of my Louisville guys gets to be a part of this. And I come and I see Funkhauser pitch in Hickory, or I come here and see Ryan Wright playing carry. And I've always made a point, if I have a guy on the USA national team, then I'm going to make the trip and I'm going to support him and let him know that I'm super proud of you. And he deserves for me to make the time and the money to be here. So I've been blessed to come here many, many times with McKay, Corey Ray, the Birdie Brothers, Devin Hairston, and down the list. I love bragging about all of our USA guys.
Well, best of luck throughout the tour. By the time people hear this, we'll have a nice update for them, hopefully with some series wins wrapped up in there as well. Coach Dan McDonnell of the Collegiate National Team in Louisville. So we promised an update. We talked to Dan McDonnell prior to the Collegiate National Team's International Friendship Series. For the summer, they finished 8 wins, 6 losses on the summer, won the Cuba series, as well as the Chinese Taipei series, and could not come away with the series versus Japan. This is the part of every episode of Covering the Bases where we bring in Brad, the media guy, to fact check our conversation because, well, he's the only one around here that really never gets anything wrong. Brad,
Hi
there.
Hi.
And what did we miss?
That's some pretty high praise there. I don't believe that's true. I'll fact check
that. I may not have said it facetiously. So take that
how you will. Before we kind of dive in here, just to touch base a little bit on the recap for the collegiate team. As Dan alluded to in the podcast, they were going for the first ever, you know, series win in Japan, and ultimately it went to a game five, a deciding game five, which is exciting. It was the, I think, 13th or 14th time in our history of the series that it's gone to a deciding game five, but unfortunately just couldn't pull it out this year. So they had a great year, though. They were really fun to watch, great group of kids. So I'll get into fact check now. So one of the first things that you mentioned when you were discussing Dan McDonnell's original time with Team USA when he was an assistant coach in 2009, that Team USA had series wins in Guatemala and Canada. We actually hosted Guatemala and Canada, so I wanted to make sure no one thought we were traveling.
Oh, I said in both
that.
Of those.
Yes,
okay, my mistake then.
So we actually hosted...
By all means, fact check me as much as you need to.
So we actually hosted Guatemala, and then we actually hosted the Canadian Junior National Team that year. So it wasn't their collegiate team. It was their junior team, but had a lot of high profile, high draft picks on that squad as well. So we actually did host them before we traveled to Japan and then to Canada.
Institutional knowledge. You see that, Colin? That's what he's here for.
Well, it just so happens I was the press officer with the 2009 team that went on that trip. So I actually got to travel with Dan McDonnell and the rest of the staff. I was their press officer and also their operations assistant. It was a very busy summer, but
okay,
a very
so
fun
you
summer.
Might have some insight as to some of these stories that Dan was telling.
I remember, yeah, a lot of things that Dan mentioned, which is exciting, and we'll get into that in just a little bit. Before we get there, he had mentioned that one of the things he learned was Eric Campbell is one of the hardest working guys he's ever been around. And for those of you who just do not know, I wanted to kind of explain who Eric Campbell is. Eric Campbell is the general manager of our national team programs. So primarily he works with the collegiate national team, but he also works closely with our professional national teams. So for instance, we have a professional national team that's coming up in October, November for Olympic qualification. He is heavily involved in the process of selecting players and identifying staff, and then also putting everything together when we're in, you know, when we're training and when we're getting ready to travel for that team. He is an incredibly hardworking guy. So I just wanted to give credit to Eric Campbell and kind of educate people a little bit about who he is and why he is the hardest working guy Dan's been around. So you immediately discussed that Dan had four guys on the roster here. He did have four guys here for the Red versus Blue series. Ultimately, only one of those four guys made the actual full national team. But then due to circumstances kind of out of our control, we had to replace someone on the roster. And he actually brought in a different guy from Louisville, Lucas Dunn. So a fifth Louisville Cardinal was involved in the collegiate team this summer, but only two actually made the full national team. That was Reed Detmers and Lucas Dunn. He also talked a little bit about when he was a player at the Citadel. So taking back to his early playing career, that they beat Miami twice in the Atlantic Regional when they got to the College World Series in 1990. Just to kind of elaborate a little bit on that, it was the only time, is the only time Citadel has ever made it to the College World Series. And it was really cool because three of the players on that team are now coaches. And they were involved in our collegiate program a little bit this summer. So Dan McDonnell was obviously the manager. Tony Skoll, who is the head coach at the Citadel now, was an assistant coach. And then Chris Lamonis was also on that team. And Chris Lamonis came and served in kind of like a task force role during the Red versus Blue. So he wasn't on the official staff yet for our collegiate team this year, but he was around working with the players when we had the expanded roster. So three of those guys that were on that team are now head coaches. Obviously, Lamonis took Mississippi State to the College World Series as well, but all three of them were involved with the team this year, which I thought was pretty cool. He was kind of talking about the College World Series now and the difference between like Rosenblatt and now TD Ameritrade. He's discussing all the home runs. And he had said that, oh, you know, there was like 13 or 14 home runs this year. There were 22 home runs hit in the 2019 College World Series. Quite a bit. Especially when he considered there was years, you know, there only like two home runs were hit and things like that. So, but this year there were 22 home runs hit to their College World Series. So the big thing now I want to talk to you a little bit around the idea of, you know, USA not winning a series against Japan in Japan for a very extended period of time, which was kind of Dan's, you know, big goal this year, was to kind of avenge that loss that we had in a deciding game five as well in 2009. So first I want to talk a little bit about the series itself. You know, he had mentioned that 1974 was the last time we won a series in Japan. It was actually 1979. 1974 was the first time we won a series in Japan. We actually won the series in Japan in 1974, 1976, and then 1979, but we have not won a five-game series in Japan, or seven-game series, actually. In the early goings, it was a seven-game series, but we have not won since then. We've come close. We've had quite a few deciding games, but that's, but unfortunately, just not since then. In fact, of the entire series, we are 3-18 all time in the series in Japan, and we're 21-1 in the United States. So Japan has only actually ever won the series one time
once when
here
it was played in the United States.
Yeah, which is crazy when you think about the tradition and the programs that these two countries have. You'd think it'd be a little bit more balanced than that, and it's not, and it's tight. You know, of all the games, the U.S. we lead 133-107. With two ties. So the series is always very, very tight. It's definitely one to watch when we play them almost every year. And then the last thing Dan mentioned, game five of the 2009
series. This is what I was getting at.
Against Japan.
Because you were there.
I was there. It was an incredible trip. He was so right about that. It's something I'll remember forever. And I remember going into that particular game thinking, oh man, we're gonna do it. And it was my second year as an intern at USA Baseball, and I was being afforded this opportunity. I was like, yeah, this is the year we're gonna win it, first time since 1979. Oh, that's great. So the game itself was kind of crazy. So Garrett Cole, obviously now with the Astros, who's just killing it, started on the bump for us. Japan went up 2-0 early. And then we were up 4-2 after the fourth inning. Then Japan came back and tied it 4-4 in the bottom of the fifth. And it stayed that way till the ninth inning. We scored 3 runs in the top of the ninth. And I remember sitting there, obviously working as a press officer, you're kind of writing your game recap as it's going on. And it was a mess. I had like a version if we won, a version if we lost. So we scored the 3 runs and I was starting to feel pretty good about it. And then we gave up the 3 runs in the bottom of the ninth inning. So it's kind of crazy with the people he name dropped a little bit of the players that were on the team. And the end of this game involved so many of them. So obviously Garrett Cole got the start. Chad Bettis came on with 2 outs in the eighth, got us out of a jam and got the first 2 outs of the ninth, but could not close it out. So we ended up giving up some runs. And then Sonny Gray came in and there was a runner on first base and he had an errant pickoff throw that got the guy to third. And then we gave up a hit to tie the game on the bottom of the ninth. And then at that point, you go into the international tiebreak. And I'm not trying to call out anybody, obviously, because he had mentioned that people were very emotional.
Just providing some clarity.
Just providing some clarity. In the bottom of the 11th inning, it was Christian Colon, who was our shortstop. We kind of referenced him as Captain America. He had been a part of Team USA for such a long time. He unfortunately had the error in the bottom of the 11th that ultimately sealed the series for Japan. I can vouch the kids truly cared. It was very refreshing to see the investment that they give. Obviously working from the side of working for USA Baseball, and you see the commitment that the staff puts in, as well as the coaching staff and all the people behind the scenes. It's equally refreshing to see a group of freshmen and sophomores in college that care that much. It was heartbreaking, yes, but it was a great series that was very well played. But unfortunately, yeah, just couldn't quite pull it out. And then after that series, we went to Canada and played in the World Baseball Challenge, which Dan kind of mentioned was a world championship. It's not really a world championship. It was just called the World Baseball Challenge.
Sure.
There was a mixture. There were some countries like Germany was there and things like that. But there were also some kind of local teams that were involved in it as well. But we ended up beating Germany in the gold medal game 8-1 behind I think it was a one hitter from Drew Pomeranz, who's obviously up in the majors and stuff now as well. So the team is pretty stacked.
Yeah, that was a loaded team.
It was incredible. If you think about just the pitchers alone, there was Cole, there was Bauer, Sonny Gray, Drew Pomeranz. Those are kind of like your big name. Chad Bettis.
Yeah.
Those were kind of your big names there. Then you had Christian Colon, infielder. Colton Wong was an infielder on that team. Brad Miller, who's with the Phillies, he was on that team. And you got a couple guys that were in the outfield that, you know, have been jumping up and down a little bit through their career, like Bryce Brentz. And Yasmani Grandal was on that team as well. He was the catcher or the one of the catchers that we had. That team was stacked. It was pretty incredible. It was a fun group, a fun group to be around for sure.
Cool. We'll appreciate the firsthand insight from Brad, the media guy, who again was there. You alluded to a couple of these things. Some really exciting stuff happening with USA Baseball. The WBSC U12 World Cup is underway in Taiwan. The USA Baseball 12U national team is going for its fourth consecutive world championship there. Here stateside, the 15U national team trials are underway, so be on the lookout. I'm actually really excited about this. Colin and company here at USA Baseball are preparing. It's a mini documentary series, sort of, I guess, highlighting the trials process and the national team selection and identification process.
Yeah, they've been working really hard on that. We're really excited to see the finished product of that. Try to give people some insight as to what actually goes on as we're looking to identify a national team program. Should be a good watch.
So be on the lookout for that. And then also, Brad, you mentioned to me prior to us recording here, the announcement of the Premier 12 coaching staff is coming soon. And for our listeners, our next guest on Covering the Bases may or may not have something to do with that announcement. So that's pretty exciting.
It's a little, get some good insight for you there, Daron. And for those of you who don't know, the Premier 12, it's a new world world championship from the WBSC, and they invite the top 12 ranked nations in the baseball rankings, and that is who makes up the field for that event. And it is a professional national team event, so you know, we'll actually get to, you know, get our hands in there with some of these up and coming prospects that should join our team, and it'll actually serve as our first bout with Olympic qualifying, trying to get involved in the Tokyo 2020 Olympic Games.
So very exciting stuff happening here at USA Baseball. To stay abreast on all of it, check out usabaseballnews.com, where you can register for updates so you'll be notified every time, for instance, we release a new episode of the podcast. We're officially on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Play. Every episode is on YouTube as well. Hit us up with a subscribe, and if you like what you hear, certainly give us a sparkling review. It would be greatly, greatly appreciated. That'll do it for us here from the press box above Coleman Field for episode 7 of Covering the Bases. Appreciate you joining us, and we'll catch you next time.